Not always so nice. You should ask my ex-husband. We're going to start with a song called Let the Mystery Be. Thank you. Think that's good. And this is by Aristonette.
Everybody is wondering what and where they all came from. Everybody is worrying about where they're gonna go when the whole thing's done. But no one knows for certain, and so it's all the same to me. Think I'll just let the mystery be. Some say once you're gone, you're gone forever, and some say you're gonna come back. Everybody is wondering what and where they all came from. Everybody is worrying about where they're gonna go when the whole thing's done. But no one knows for certain, so it's all the same to me. Think I'll just let the mystery be.
Thank you, Elizabeth. So this is called The Gift of Mystery. And I was inspired by a sermon by the UU minister, Barbara Myers, who preaches in Mission Peak Unitarian Universalist congregation. And she started off a little bit about talking about mysticism and the word that definitely relates to mystery. And she describes it as sort of a conscious awareness of the divine or spiritual truth, what some people might call God through a direct experience or through your own intuition or through insight. And mysticism is at the heart of most every religion. And mystical insights can be attained in two ways: by direct divine intervention, as in some Western religions, such as Christianity and Judaism and Islam, or inward contemplation, as in such Eastern religions, such as Buddhism and Hinduism and Taoism. In any case, it's an intuitive process in which logic and reason don't often play a big part. Ralph Waldo Emerson, who is one of our greatest Unitarian thinkers, he claimed that he had many experiences that he would call mystical or religious, experiences where he felt connected to something larger than himself. He wrote, "The greatest delight which the fields and woods minister is the suggestion of a relationship between man and the vegetable." He wrote this many years ago. "I'm not alone, and I'm not unacknowledged. They nod to me, and I to them." And he went so far and defined three characteristics of mysticism. The first, that mystical knowledge is mysterious and not within our power to ever completely grasp. And he wrote that man is a stream whose source is hidden. Man is a stream whose source is hidden. Second, mysticism involves some sense of knowing or joining with an ultimate reality, whether God, as we understand that word, or whether connection to another person or to a place or a thing. And thirdly, Emerson believed that we cannot create mystical experiences or really ever bring them back, but they do come in their own time. And the key to Emerson's thought is what we know as our first source of our Unitarian Universalist living tradition, which is in our gray hymnals. And I'll read it to you. It's the direct experience of transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, which moves us to the renewal of the spirit and an openness to the forces which create and uphold life. Mysticism can arrive in many different forms, in conversations, in passion, in surprise, in dreams, in meditations, in prayer, contemplation, chanting, dancing, and nature. And as is true of many other mystics, a vision or a feeling only lasts a few seconds, but in those few seconds, it can change your lifetime. I have what I frame as a mystical experience in my 20s. For me, it was a near-death experience. I was in the hospital, and I had a really strong reaction to a drug that I was given. And in the moment before I went into anaphylactic shock, which lasted for about a week, I felt like I was underground. And I was almost like being underground in a subway, but I could look above the ground. And I could see my parents holding out their hands. And they were running one way, and I was reaching towards them another way. And there I could hear the whooshing of the train. And this vision for me only lasted just a few seconds, but it was really powerful. And I can still see it today. And then, about 35 years later, I also had another dream of that same train. And this time, I couldn't really see who's in the train, but I could hear that whooshing. And then I woke up and I found out that my mother had passed that night. Now, this vision to me has lasted with me my whole life. I don't really understand it, and I don't really worry about finding an explanation for it, but it has definitely become a touchstone for my life. And it's opened a pathway in my heart that can never be closed. And it's opened a pathway when I hear other people talk about their mystical experiences. Now, when you look at different religious traditions, you can see a lot of evidence of mysticism. It quickly becomes clear that many founders of all the major religions were mystics. And here are just a few examples. In Eastern religions, such as Buddhism, insight comes from developing one's intuition by reflective contemplation. For example, Buddhism. Mystical insight came from Buddha, who sat under the Bodhi tree. In Christianity, you hear stories from the Bible about Jesus hearing voices. And then you read about all the famous mystics, St. John the Divine, St. Francis, Meister Eckhart, Julian of Norwich, who we're going to sing a song about at the end of this sermon, and St. Teresa. That first source of our living tradition in our hymnal is the direct experience of that transcending mystery and wonder affirmed in all cultures, which moves us to a renewal of the spirit and just an openness to the forces which create and uphold life. Now, our fourth source is humanist teachings, which counsel us to heed the guidance of reason and the results of science and warn us against idolatries in the mind and the spirit. There is another sermon written by Sarah Richards, and she preaches at Carbondale Unitarian Fellowship in Illinois. And she talks about the two roots of mysticism, the mystical, the two roots of Unitarianism, I'm sorry, the mystical and the scientific. And they've often been seen as conflicting, people driven by the heart versus the head, or the warm-hearted, fuzzy-headed mystic versus the coldly intellectual scientist, accepting only those ideas that are empirically proven. And we definitely have both people on that camp in our congregation. I'm not going to name you. But I know a few of them are here this morning. And this is kind of a simplistic way to look at our principles, but for some reason it persists in our religion, that duality. One can say that the mystic and the scientific outlook and that attitude, they share more than they differ. And insights come when we see these as complementary perspectives in our search for our own spiritual truth. For example, there is a book written by Ursula Goodenough called The Sacred Depths of Nature. And she writes, "We are all, each one of us, ordained to live out our lives in the context of ultimate questions, such as, why is there anything at all? rather than nothing. Where did the laws of physics actually come from? And why does that universe look so strange? Well, her answer to such questions has been for her to articulate a covenant with the mystery of the unknown. She says the realization that I needn't have answers to the big questions has served for me as an epiphany. I lie back on my back under the stars and the unseen galaxies, and I let their enormity wash over me. I assimilate the vastness of the distances, the impermanence, the fact of it all. And I go all the way out, and then I go all the way down to the fact of photons without mass and gauge bosons that become massless at high temperatures. A covenant with mystery, that's what that cell biologist. And that to me resonates with me. It demonstrates the interconnection between our human drive to understand, to come to the end of the story, and also the experience of the mystery, the understanding for me that there will never be answers to all of our questions. So I take from her writing that we all have the capacity to be scientists and mystics, depending on the questions and our own experiences of our mind. We all can accept all of our guiding principles and not really have to exclude one or the other. I thought about that when I read over our Soul Matters packet. And by the way, if anybody wants to join us on Friday at 2:30, we are having a Soul Matters group. And anybody who wants to learn more about it can ask me after during the service or after the service. But one of the questions that came up for us in that packet was, do you spend more time treating life like a problem to be solved or a mystery to be lived? And I think we need to be scientists and problem solvers and skeptics and mystics to live in this world fully. And that's my good enough and prepared answer. Neither a mystic or a scientist, but both a mystic and a scientist with respect to our new principles. So December is a big month for miraculous, unexplainable events. How did that jug of oil, only enough for one day, fuel the temple lamp for eight? How did a star guide shepherds and the magi to a single stable in the city of Bethlehem? And the biggest question for me is, how does Santa Claus manage to deliver all those gifts to the apartment buildings and crawl down the chimneys? These holiday conundrums encourage us to take just a little break from trying to understand, from trying to solve a mystery, and just to let it be. They encourage us to not wait until we fully understand behaviors, to not wait until we fully understand compassion, but to emulate compassion ourselves. So friends, may we articulate a covenant with mysteries of the season. May we show goodwill to all people, and may peace and justice remain alive in our world today. And now your thoughts. I would love to hear feedback, any mystical experiences you've had. And I don't know if we should maybe pass the microphone around, but please feel free to add to it. comments, your thoughts, and Zoom as well. Yeah.